Listening Library presents Bumps in the Night by Amalie Howard. Read for you by Yasmin Mwanza. For my son, Noah, the most Trini to the bone of my kids. All skin tea to laugh. Trinidadian expression meaning that friendly appearances can be deceiving, and some smiles should not be trusted. Chapter 1. Pride and Punishment. Airports have to be the first places to go in an apocalypse. From the plane's window, I watch a 5-year-old pick his nose a few feet in front of me before using those same wet, goopy fingers to grab the handrail as he and his parents exit down the rollaway stairs. I cringe, reach for the hand sanitizer attached to my backpack, and squeeze out a large dollop. I wrinkle my nose at the people swarming the aisle to leave the airplane, where they'll be touching that same booger rail. It only takes one infected person and bam, mass contagion. That kid could be patient zero, and within seconds, everyone's hungry for each other's brains. Instant zombie apocalypse. Not that zombies exist, but a girl can't be too careful. Stepping through the rounded plane door, I blink at the thick, bleary heat blasting into my face at the top of the stairs. Holy melting Skittle Farms, the Caribbean is hot. Not like bone-dry summer hot, but sticky, humid, take a dozen showers to stay cool hot. Already my armpits are sweating into the cotton of my tank top, and I've only just arrived at the destination indicated on the plane ticket tucked in the front pocket of my backpack. Port of Spain, it reads. The capital of Trinidad and Tobago. Might as well say port of prison, because that's what Granny's house will be, my jail cell for the next 3 months. It had been her idea when my dad called her a month ago out of frustration. I had been written up for vandalism, again, though no charges had been pressed against me by my school, thank goodness. But I'd been royally grounded. No phone, no drawing tablet, no anything. I couldn't text friends, I couldn't sketch, I couldn't even use my computer to game. And now I've been banished to another country for the whole summer without any of my stuff. To be fair, I knew this was coming. This was the last straw. Those words replay in my mind in Dad's grim voice, and my heart squashes in my chest. I could have done my homework, gotten better grades, stopped cutting school, and not drawn on public property. Stop feeling sorry for yourself, Rika, I tell myself. 3 months is nothing. Get over it. Sure. 3 months of trying not to die of boredom. And who knows what Granny has planned? She is a weathered battle axe who lives on an estate in the middle of nowhere, grows her own fruit in a massive orchard, sews her own clothes, and is just weird. I used to think she was made of magic when I was younger, that she had eyes in the back of her head that saw everything. She'd tell me stories about witchcraft that would have my spine curling and my blood crawling. Myths of monsters and jumbies, creepy lost children called duendes whose feet faced backwards, and a shape-shifting woman called La Dibliese who came in the night to steal the souls of children. Only she said it like La Diablesse. I remember shivering in terrified delight when Granny teased that kids' bones were always soft and delicious. I used to live for her tales, but I guess they're about as real as zombies. Now I can only think about the fact that Granny has no internet. I'll be cut off from everything and everyone, and by the time summer ends in this heat, I'm probably gonna dissolve into a sad puddle of melty goo that no one back home will even recognize. On cue, a hot gust steams into my entire body like it's cackling in the face of my epic pity party, and I sigh. Even the weather is against me. I give a half-hearted wave to the airline representative waiting at the base of the rollway stairs and force my legs to move. It feels like I'm moving through syrup in the heat. "Miss Lovelace Rose," the woman says when I reach the bottom. Mom always said names have power, and apparently ours does. So Lovelace Rose it is. I nod. That's me. Unaccompanied minor and future goo puddle. Unwanted miscreant and trouble with a capital T. "Welcome to Trinidad and Tobago," she says, her accent soft and musical. Tanya, her name tag reads. That starts with T, too. I wonder if she ever got sent away by her dad to some strange place when she was younger. She's beautiful. Tall, with brown skin several shades darker than mine, and a red-lipped smile that's so wide, it makes you want to grin back. I'm not ready to stop sulking, so I mumble noncommittal responses to her friendly questions about the flight and whether I'd been to Trinidad before. "Yes, it was fine. I don't want to be here. Once, a few years ago, my life officially sucks." After we get through the lines in immigration, where my passport is scrutinized and stamped, Tanya eyes me. "It says here in my packet that a Mrs. Lovelace will be meeting you?" she asks. "My grandmother." "Okay, let's get your luggage, then wait for her." This airport is much smaller than the one I left from in the United States, and the large open windows let in a warm breeze that smells of a rainstorm and fresh-tilled earth. Colorful brown-green foliage sways in the distance, a rise of darker purple-hued mountains looming behind it. A plump lizard sunning on one of the sills catches my attention. No, not a lizard. More like a baby iguana. As long as my forearm, from elbow to wrist. It's a brilliant green with black tail markings, and looks like a miniature dragon without the wings. For an instant, its eye connects with mine until a long pink tongue slicks over it, which is somehow simultaneously gross and kind of adorable. Keeping my face stoic, I look away. I don't want to be charmed by or like anything about this place. Not the cool reptiles, not the fresh smells, not the friendly, smiling faces like Tanya's. Last time I was here, I was 9, more than 3 years ago, before Mom left, before Dad got remarried to Cassie, before my stepbrothers Max and Theo came, before everything in my life went downhill. I stare at my scuffed sneakers, feeling sorry for myself again, when the hairs on the back of my neck stand up. Shuddering and resisting the urge to rub my nape, I glance over my shoulder. My gaze instantly snags on a thin-faced but gorgeous woman with her hair scraped back beneath a wide-brimmed hat sauntering through the crowd. My adrenaline spikes, like when you enter a pitch-black room and can't find the light switch or right before the jump scare you know is coming in a scary movie. As she sails past me, her floor-length red gown way too fancy for the airport, my skin crawls. Something about her feels off. A strange noise fills my ears, like a swarm of buzzing flies, or the faint rattle of chains. Stomach rolling, stark terror grips me in a giant fist. My breath stutters in my throat, and I drop my eyes. "Don't look at me. Don't look at me. Don't look at me," I chant silently. On instinct, I shift, so I'm hidden behind Tanya's ample form out of the woman's sight, though I can still see her. Her flowy, old-style dress reminds me of a fancy ball gown, and her face is so still, it's unnerving. Those wide-set eyes don't blink, and her mouth doesn't move in that gruesome rictus. I narrow my gaze. Her chest doesn't move either, for that matter. Why isn't she breathing? Is she dead? Undead? When a pair of milky eyes sweeps in my direction, every muscle in my quaking...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.